So since the entire day, I mean from yesterday or even day before, the entire sessions were bombarded with a lot of command line, and since most of you were not used to it, so for DSEC I thought it would be a bit easier for us to kind of switch to an online version, right? Apart from that, as I said, we have a script with us, which is publicly available as well. I told you Mr. Harish has written it, and it is like it's like a what should I say, a genie in the bottle kind of a thing, wherein you just have to run the script and it will give you n number of outputs. We have tailored it to, I mean, he has rather, he has tailored it to cater to all sorts of DSEC and differential gene expression analysis need, right from automating upregulated and downregulating genes to displaying pertaining graphs for the same. So that script is also there. And the best part is it is publicly available also. So if we have time, we'll try to use that also. At first place, we'll be sticking to the online DSEC. So first of all, let us understand ki DSEC actually karta kya hai, right? What exactly it does. I suppose all of us are ready with the input files, first of all. I just wanted a confirmation on that. Are we ready with the input files as per the instructions? Are we ready with those files?
Yes, I
Yeah.
am. Yes.
Okay. Great, great, great. Now I hope no, abhi nahi hope. Now let me share my screen. Yeah, can you see my presentation? Points to be noted?
Yes, you can see. Yes.
Okay, great. So there are a few points that we need to keep in mind before we move over to DSEC data analysis. First is that the count data that we get, it is not normalized. So you need to normalize it because there are certain factors that influence read alignment. So longer transcripts will obviously attract more reads, right? And if you directly translate the number of reads into your gene's expression, then there might be a bias towards transcripts which are longer in length. So, and again, higher copy number trans higher yeah so higher expression or higher copy number transcripts will attract more reads. So you need to normalize your read count in a way that an unambiguous and unbiased overview of a particular gene's expression is recorded. Also, one more thing that I had explained previously was that if you are using paired end data to count or calculate differential gene expression, then you will count the forward and reverse read as a single fragment. You will not count it twice as you would have done in case of single end data, right? So there is a very what should I say, it becomes very necessary for us to normalize the read count data before we move to differential gene expression analysis. So for that very purpose, we use a tool called DESEC. And moreover, so the next stage that we are on to is differential gene expression, wherein we analyze gene expressions. So we perform statistical analysis on normalized read counts, which are both done internally by the tool. And through this, we can discover quantitative changes in the expression level between transcripts in different conditions, inter-intra both, like between transcripts of the same in the same sample or between two different samples of two samples of different conditions. You can utilize that. And then once you get your set of differentially expressed genes, you can validate that results through your experiments, which are wet lab based, right? So differential gene expression analysis will more often than not gives us an overall insight into the mechanism. Say if you are tackling a disease, you are working on a disease, or say those who are coming from a plant background, those who are talking about effect of change in environmental conditions over the growth of a crop, right? So different different set of problems involve more or less different expression levels amongst genes, right? So that is what you can track through DG, differential gene expression analysis. So what we are using is an online version of DSeq2. Here we are specifically covering the offline one, which is an R based package, right? So any bias that is introduced in your data due to, as I said, transcript size, or say the bias between higher expressing transcripts and lower expressing transcripts at the time of sequencing, library size biases, and all these things are normalized at first place by DSeq. And then it kind of allows the user to segregate their genes on the basis of your p-value to, you know, kind of filter out only the statistically relevant results, and then on the basis of log fold change, right? Log to fold change. So if we look at the resources that are needed, we need a count data matrix, which we created just now. The file which we have named as input DSeq, that has the count data matrix, basically the read count information of all different conditions in a single file. And then phenodata, the second thing is phenodata or the metadata file, the second file which we had created, in which we had the various conditions and their respective replicates. The metadata file which we had created, Abhi, that caters to the second resource that we need for running DSeq. So what are we planning to do here? We are planning to run DSeq on raw data, on the raw count file. DSeq will normalize it, and then it will give out results wherein a normalized count along with log to fold change and p value would be provided to us in the form of an Excel sheet, which we'll be working on later on. Now, this is how you run the command. This is the template for the command. If you are running it on R, first you have to activate R by typing R, on your terminal, and then you have to just run this command here. So this is the input file or the input variable on which your command will act, and will provide you a list of files and folders. It's not this straightforward. That is why Hariji's script would be used if we get time to switch on to the offline use of the same. And that script will calculate, automatically curate the input according to our needs, and will automatically filter out upregulated and downregulated genes depending on the criteria that they fulfill, right? So this is roughly how your DSeq output will look like. So this is the gene IDs in the first column, then you have log to fold change, then you have p values, then you have different samples and their respective adjusted count values, right? Normalization is utmost necessary because there are several biases which might express your gene, which might influence your gene expression. So in order to calculate an unbiased gene expression, you will have to normalize your read counts, which DSeq2 does internally, right? Now, if we have to talk about criteria for differentially expressed genes, well, we can split them into three categories. First, if the log to fold change is greater than or equal to 2, and p value is less than or equal to 0.05, then you can call it as an upregulated gene. If it is less than -2 and p value again is less than 0.05, then you can categorize it as a downregulated gene. And if it is somewhere between -1 and 1, then you can categorize it as a housekeeping gene. Basically, genes which are responsible for the proper functioning of a cell. Right. So these are the three criteria that we can segregate our list of genes into. Fine. Moving on, there are few points to be noted that many pipelines use FPKM based normalization. So if you have FPKM normalized reads, then you should not forcibly feed them to DSeq, because DSeq internally performs normalization. So you will have double normalized data, which might give you ambiguous results. And secondly, replicate based application of DSeq is that you ought to have replicate data available, then only you can run the latest module of DSeq, and then only you will get a much more validated results. Also, as discussed previously, your sample should be present in triplicates for the differentially expressed genes that are coming up, for them to be considered as valid results, right? So I request Hariji to stop recording so that I can move on to the hands-on part.